I don't think I've had such an introduction before. As it was mentioned, I flew here from the Australian summer, and this is probably my first social gathering in the last 1.5 years, so I might be a bit nervous, and let me know if I don't make any sense. And I would like to thank you very much to fly me here to this winter wonderland in Sweden. It's really beautiful. So I probably don't really need to tell you much about ecosystem collapses and the global decline of biodiversity. And because of this, there is a growing interest in restoring ecosystems. Even the UN named this 10 years the decade of ecosystem restoration. So today I will talk about one way of helping nature, which is reintroducing fauna, regaining functions, and restoring ecosystems. But first, I just wanted to show all these people I'm really grateful to, because I couldn't have done any of the work I did without them. And I studied and I work at La Trobe University, which is pretty, it's not a big and famous uni, but it's really nice. It's in the middle of a woodland, and it's doing a great effort in making itself sustainable and becoming net zero by 2029. And the other thing I think is really important is it's the world's second higher education institution in gender equality. So I think these are two pretty important things for a university. So let's talk about restoration. Restoration usually aims to increase biodiversity, and then hoping that with biodiversity, ecosystem functions will follow. And there's a passive type of restoration when, for example, you stop cropping land, let it be and just hope for the best. Or you can do a more active restoration when you're planting trees and then hope that the birds will come. But translocation and rewilding type of restoration is more active, so you're physically introducing species to an area where they might have been extinct from, instead of waiting for them to just come naturally. And I mainly study this type of rewilding when a species might be extinct from an area, but they are still they still occur in the broader geographic range, and you try and reintroduce them again where they are extinct from. And you can introduce them because you want to save them from extinction, but I'm mostly interested in introducing species to fulfill their ecological roles again. So the first half of my talk is about my PhD project, which is summarized in my essay. And it's rewilding with threatened digging mammals in Australia. And the second part of my talk is about much smaller things. It's about rewilding with invertebrates, and we like to call these invertebrates mini beasts in our lab. But first, I would like to stop for a second to acknowledge the First Nations people of Australia, who cared for the land for thousands of years. And I live and work in Melbourne, which is the stolen land of the Wurundjeri people. And I pay my respect to their elders, past and present. And I did most of my work in southeastern Australia. So you can see the long list of the traditional owners of the land I did my research on. But I spent most of my time on Kokatha, Noongar and Barkindji country. And of course, the European colonization didn't only affect the indigenous people, but it had a huge impact on wildlife. So many plant and animal species faced extinction because of clearing land for agriculture and invasive predators from Europe, like the cats and foxes. So my project is focusing on digging mammals, and they are, I think they are more well-known ones, like in the bottom, the echidnas or the wombat, which might be famous for its cubicle poops. But there are some less known ones on top. They are the bilbies, numbets, bandicoots, and betongs. And they are probably less well known because they're quite rare, because they've been eaten by the cats and the foxes. So they're mostly extinct from mainland Australia, and they only survive in predator-proof fenced reserves, like this one on the picture, and they look like little nature prisons, really. But that's what you have to do if you want to keep these small digging mammals alive. So I thought I'd show you what these digging mammals do in their free time, which is just digging lots of holes for food. And this is a greater bilby, which is just really busy all night long, just digging nonstop pretty much. And it's really hard to imagine that the loss of this digging activity doesn't have an effect on ecosystems, because you can see on the pictures, these are all digging mammal, like the traces of the digging mammals, and they just dig around constantly. So they must have really important roles in the ecosystem. So it's a little bit like tilling. They aerate the soil. In those little holes, soil nutrients and soil moisture accumulate, and they also distribute a lot of seeds and other resources, like the potoro, which is that little elephant-looking thing. It's the original truffle hunter, because it's really good at finding truffles and then distributing their spores wherever it goes. So we wanted to know what functions are lost from the ecosystem after the extinction of a whole suite of digging mammals. And to answer this question, we used fenced reintroduction areas where all these native mammals have been reintroduced into fenced properties. So you can see, obviously, one side of the fence have digging mammals, and the other side of the fence is just, they're extinct from there. So we wanted to look at the big picture and look at reserves over the environmental gradient. So I was quite lucky to just drive around all across southern Australia and visit these beautiful reserves across a rainfall gradient. So the driest reserve was receives 160 mils per year. And the wettest reserve receives almost 900 millimeters per year. And I took soil samples from inside and outside the reserves for 2 years. And I looked at microbe communities, microbe functions, a little bit of metagenomics, but I was most interested in soil processes. And in our lab, we also look at invertebrate communities and food webs. How do they respond to the extinction of these native mammals? So what did we find? After analyzing more than 1,300 samples, did native digging mammals affect soil microbes and soil processes? Well, the answer is yes and yes. We found that microbe diversity, for example, was higher on average in the reintroduction reserves. But this difference was only significant in the arid and the semi-arid areas. And I found a similar trend with soil available carbon, where on average the values were higher in the reintroduction reserves, but only significantly higher in arid and the semi-arid reserves. So I took my results and tried to model a pre-European Australia, imagining that all these digging mammals are still hopping around everywhere. They didn't go extinct. There's no cats and foxes. So you can see the rainfall map of Australia on with the blue, and the reserves I visited. And so I predicted based on my results, I just predicted for pretty much the whole continent how would it look like. But I didn't predict for high rainfall areas like Tasmania and the Australian alpine areas, because I never went to such high rainfall areas. And I also never went to the tropics. That's why the northern bit of Australia is blank. So let's see what would it look like with and without the digging mammals. So you can see there's a huge difference between the two states of pre-European and the current Australia in the available carbon and in the surface soils. And there is even a bigger difference if you look at the soil layers, which are like 10, 15 centimeters below. And if you study your rainfall map careful enough, you can see that. I can't find the mouse, but
it's on the screen.
Oh, I just can't find it here. I just can't see.
So now it's a laser.
Oh, combinations. Yes, thanks. So you can find here is where the semi-arid and arid regions of the country are, and that's where the biggest difference is between between the two states. And this is probably where soil moisture and soil nutrients is the most important for an ecosystem in the arid and semi-arid areas. So if we think about climate change, the world might become more and more like Australia. So we really need to stop biodiversity loss and make smarter decisions about our future now. And rewilding is one way of doing it, because rewilding will build resilience to ecosystems. And we saw them, soil microbes and the functions change since the extinction of these mammals. But then it makes us wonder, what else did we lose, which we might not know about. So it's quite easy to study and reintroduce these charismatic animals, because who wouldn't want to invest in such cuddly, fluffy, cute animals to have on their reserves? However, invertebrates are doing probably 70% of ecosystem services, and they are the little things who run the world. But because they're understudied and probably less appealing, it's really hard to invest in the conservation of them. But looking at these pictures, you don't really have to convince me that they are the best. So that's why we wanted to test if we can reintroduce invertebrates and soil fauna to degraded lands, such as agricultural windbreaks. And these windbreaks are just basically strips of native trees which are left to just grow. So there's no cropping or no grazing on those little areas, which you can see, for example, here. But because this patch of native vegetation is pretty much in the middle of a biological desert, probably invertebrates would find it quite hard to make their way into these native patches of land. So we thought maybe we could help them. So we went to nearby remnant forest sites and collected a whole heap of litter and surface soil into big bags, and then dumped it all to these strips of trees, and then see what happened. But we also left a couple of areas without these litter transplants to then we can compare what changed. And there's lots of things we were testing, and we are still collecting samples and continuing the experiment. But for example, you can see it changed the invertebrate richness a little bit. So if the bars are moving to the right, it means that our transplants worked. And this peach color bar is the baseline, so before those transplants, and then from there the bars move to the right, it means the transplants increased in richness. So you can see beetles and two types of mite richness increased since the transplants. But the colambulans don't really seem to care about our transplants very much. Maybe they are quite mobile, so they don't need our help. So we do think that litter and soil transplants might aid degraded areas in returning invertebrates and their functions. But we're still collecting samples, so many more results could follow. And I thought I could finish off with another possible application of this rewilding idea, which is about helping nature after natural disturbances like fire. So Australia experienced the unprecedented fire season in 2019 and 2020, which was a result of a long drought and really hot temperatures. And these black summer bushfires affected an area bigger than England and killed almost 50% of Gondwana rainforest in southern Australia. And there was estimated millions of vertebrates killed, and we can't even think of how many invertebrates died in this one single fire event. So we wanted to know if we could aid the severely burnt forest with these litter transplants. So one thing I was looking at was native land snails, and not surprisingly, native land snail occurrence significantly decreased with the burn severity. But their occurrence was increasing with unburned little patches of the area within the fire footprint. So probably refuges like big wet logs are quite important in these invertebrate survival, and even probably small mammal survival as well. And probably the best would have been if we could have done the whole heap of logs and structures, like woody structures, as refugees for invertebrates and small invertebrates before the fire, but of course you can't do that. So at the moment we are creating these post hoc refugees for the surviving invertebrates, because as you can see on this middle picture, the burnt rainforest floor don't really have anything to offer to anything, and there's no resources and there's no refugees for invertebrates there. So we thought invertebrates could use a little help from their friends. And this, on this picture, you can see these really big bags we were dragging along from unburnt rainforest floors to the burnt rainforest, and scatter it around to just boost the complexity of the habitat. And this is also still ongoing, this project, so I can't really show you any results, but we are hoping that we can help these invertebrates to recolonize after such catastrophic disturbances. So if you zoned out a little bit this morning, that's okay, because here is the summary of my talk. So reintroducing native fauna will restore ecosystem functions and I think increase resilience to climate change. And refugees and native habitat is probably key for wildlife to survive and recover after disturbances, let them be natural or not natural. And that was my talk, and that's my favorite snail on this log, and yeah, thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Orsi, for this insightful talk. So, questions for Orsi? I think maybe I can start. So, you said in pre-European times there were no foxes. Why did people bring foxes and cats with them? And these are wild animals, I believe.
Yeah, mainly for hunting. So, yeah. So they brought rabbits for hunting, but there's too much rabbits. So then they brought foxes to get rid of rabbits, but then they didn't get rid of any of them, and they just got rid of the native animals. So, yeah, it's just for pleasure.
Yeah. And for this fence system, as you called nature prison, how does it really stop the digging animals?
It has a skirt underground.
Okay.
So it goes underground and then has a skirt, and it has a floppy top. So if anything climbs it, it just like flops back.
I see.
So it can't go. Yeah.
Really a prison. Yeah. Okay. Questions for Orsi? Please.
So how do you train your dog to sniff the the special invertebrates?
It's pretty easy, actually. I think there's this new era of ecology where you can, you know, use dogs to sniff out things or just use environmental DNA to find species, because it's extremely hard to find, for example, land snails. I couldn't believe it how long we had to go and look for them. And it's the same for other invertebrates. So I always thought, it would be so easy to just have a dog, and then they can just say, this is where you have to dig your snail out, and I don't have to do useless rounds of it. And yeah, it's really easy to, it's called nose work. So I told my dog to sniff out specific scents in the garden, but it's really useful. And like, for example, they use dogs to find injured wildlife after the fires. So like those famous burnt koalas, like they just let the dogs and they just sniff the poop of the koala and just say, here it is. So it's pretty much the same as teaching any tricks, really. Yeah.
Hi. So we have always been taught in school that the ecological system in Australia is very delicate. So it's on a very delicate balance, and anything foreign that you introduce may harm its ecological system. So when you go into Australia, they check the bottom of your shoes to remove any soil and stuff like that. So when you kind of introduce this invertebrates, even though it's kind of like native invertebrates, but you kind of introduce them to an already kind of weak ecosystem, how do you make sure that this introduction of like much higher number of invertebrates won't actually make a negative effect on the delicate system?
Yeah, I don't know. It's really, there are always different rules apply for invertebrates and vertebrates, so there's less, it's considered less dangerous to move invertebrates around, but in these degraded areas, you can't. It's already so bad, you can't really do any harm, because the problem is that it's revegetated, but there's only trees, there's no understory, there's very little litter layer, the soil is really dry, so there's not much for anything really to live in. And first we wanted to just create this, you know, this complexity of the understory where you can get, you know, litter accumulation, logs, and just like what you would see in a forest. And but then we realized that there's so many flightless invertebrates who just can't get there, even though if you create a great habitat, they just still can't get there, because they'd have to go through these kilometers and kilometers of pastures with just cows and pasture grasses. So then we started to look at actually collecting invertebrates and look what will go. And I think the sad thing is that those degraded places, they're already, they're full of introduced invertebrates. Like Portuguese millipedes are pretty abundant because they are the only ones who can deal with such degraded areas. So, and if you go to remnant forests, if you go from the edges to the middle, it's not really likely to find introduced invertebrates. So it's a bit tricky because, yeah, as you said, it's hard to tell, but the level of degradation is so high that you just can't really do any more harm to it.
I think for the sake of time, thank you very much for this insight talk again.